Well, good morning. Ed, if you only knew how much I appreciated you and the team this morning. I don't know for lay folks, you know, I live in this interesting world where some Sunday mornings I'm Joe Lazy Church Guy rolling in at 9:31, but then some Sundays I get to be up here, you know, so it's a great perspective builder. And if you're wondering, if you're a lay person, like what's a person do that has to stand up on a Sunday morning before a holy God to prepare for this kind of event? Well, just some 12 hours ago, I was at a barn that was hosting a wedding reception with a fairly large dance floor and perhaps a pretty big window that served as an open bar. And so just if you're wondering, some 12 hours ago, I was exposed to a steady dose of Snoop Dogg. And that was part of my preparation for this morning. So if you want to say an extra prayer this morning as I pray, we'll do that now, okay? God, we're grateful. You are a holy God, and what a chorus to sing. Not our will, but yours be done. We sung about a conquering God this morning, a God who's conquered the grave. We've sung about the freedoms that we have in Jesus. And today we rejoice in that today, God. We praise you for being a great and mighty God, who the psalmist proclaimed over and over again, greatly to be praised. So this morning, may you get the praise, the honor, and the glory for the remainder of this service. May the words that I bring be from your word and led and guided by your spirit. And may you give us open hearts and minds to hear what your Holy Spirit has to say to us this morning. Thanks for the mission and ministry of Christ Community Church. And may your will be done here. Amen. And amen. So I had a thought as I was driving around the traffic at the fairgrounds this morning that, you know, if we took a show of hands, how many of us are good with right now we just like get up and we all walk a few blocks and we hold the rest of this service amongst the folks there. Take a little bit of the gospel into the car meet this morning. And, you know, I'm only half joking when I say that. I think that we could be a people to get really creative in these days and times, and what would it look like to have a CCC tent out there this morning, just allowing people to come up and maybe a little 7-minute message for those that actually missed church to be a part of that today. So perhaps some food for thought. I want us this morning to begin by taking a look at two competing agendas that are rising up these days in the American church. And some of you have read about what the first agenda I want to discuss is happening to bubble up. And it's been written about extensively by leading evangelical voices like Dr. Erwin Lutzer and so many more. And they're referring to it today as the progressive Christianity movement. And I don't know how many of you have read or heard much of this lately, but let me give you some of the ways that this movement's being defined. The leading voices in this new ideology want to make the narrow door in the narrow road that Jesus described in the Sermon on the Mount a bit wider. They advance their cause under the banner of equality and justice. This theological worldview is very much aligned with the emergent church movement of the late 90s and early 2000s. That fortunately has sort of come and gone. It's a liberalism that shifts the authority of Scripture to human opinion, moral relativism, and situational ethics. It's an attempt to abandon some of the harder edges of biblical Christianity and align our faith with cultural sensitivity. The progressive movement interprets the Bible through the lens of culture rather than engaging the culture through the lens of the Holy Scriptures. It's willing to re-examine, redefine, and ultimately reject core evangelical Christian doctrine. And believe it when I tell you that it's happening in good, strong churches across America today. Not only strong churches, good parachurch ministry organizations, good Christian universities and colleges, it is well underway. And the second agenda that has risen up, especially because of the last 2 years or so, what we've endured in our nation. Many of you have read of what the popular culture is referring to as the Great Resignation, and so many people switching careers, so many people having a couple of years to determine what's really important, what they value, their time-life balances, et cetera, their family-life balances, their work-life balances, all of these things. So the Great Resignation that's taking place in our nation at large, in the popular culture, is also pervasive within the church. But I want us to think about what's happening specifically with the pastoral leadership within churches. Because by the thousands, they're either resigning or even worse, remaining in their current leadership roles at churches. And yet, as a recent Christianity Today feature article titled "Emptied Out" proclaims, they're no longer passionate or called to lead a gospel mission. They're staying basically in their church leadership roles for the steady paycheck and the health insurance. And the empirical research on this says that's not by the hundreds across our land, that's by the thousands. So with these two movements underway, we contemplate what the current reality of a nation mired in challenges like which, with the likes of which many of us have never experienced in our lifetime, including friends among us this morning who are facing health challenges, career challenges, inflation and money challenges, addiction challenges, which can often lead to, unfortunately, marriage and family challenges. And our world is facing, on the global stage, war challenges, food insecurity and water shortage challenges, human trafficking challenges, global economic challenges that are beyond us, right? And perhaps you may relate to one of my younger work colleagues as we talked about what's been going on globally in recent months, in the last couple of years, and his terminology perhaps captures it. He said, you know, I feel sometimes like we're in a constant state of beatdown. I just feel like I'm in a constant state of beatdown. So this morning, I want us to look at some of the encouraging words of Jesus, yet the wisdom that he gives us and the direction that he gives us is so, in my mind, timely for this challenging season. I want us to begin with Matthew, the Gospel of Matthew chapter 16, and we will take a look at what will be mostly red letters from a couple of his gospel accounts this morning. Matthew 16, beginning with verse 1. The Pharisees and the Sadducees came to Jesus and they tested him by asking him to show them a sign from heaven. And he replied, "When evening comes, you say it will be fair weather for the sky is red. And in the morning, today it will be stormy for the sky is red and overcast. You know how to interpret the appearance of the sky, but you cannot interpret the signs of the times. A wicked and adulterous generation looks for a sign, but none will be given except the sign of Jonah." Jesus then left them and went away. It's a similar passage when you look at the Synoptic Gospels, and Luke picks up, again, the way he rendered this teaching from Jesus. And we'll look at Luke chapter 12, beginning with verse 54, reading through 56. He said to the crowd, "When you see a cloud rising in the west, immediately you say, 'It's going to rain,' and it does. And when the south wind blows, you say, 'It's going to be hot,' and it is. Hypocrites! You know how to interpret the appearance of the earth and the sky. How is it then that you don't know how to interpret this present time?" Could he be asking those questions of us today? Jesus was speaking not only to religious leaders, religious folk from the temple worship. Basically, think about this. We are in a society where we learn much about much. But Jesus is asking, "But do you not understand the essence of the gospel? You're seeing the signs of the times. Are you interpreting them through the lens of the gospel. Is that a word for the American Christian church this morning? The Apostle Paul stays with this theme in his letter to the Romans. Romans chapter 13, looking at verses 11 and 12. And do this, understanding the present time. The hour has already come for you to wake up from your slumber, because our salvation is nearer now than when we first believed. The night is nearly over, the day is almost here. So let us put aside the deeds of darkness and put on the armor of light. Our clarion call as Christians is to be salt and light in this increasingly dark world. So what does it look like? What does it mean practically for you and me to set aside or throw off these deeds of darkness and to wear or to put on the armor of the light of the gospel? We probably don't need this type of reminder on a Sunday morning, but indulge me on this, because last Sunday morning, before I left for a church service that was outside in a small Indiana town, I was able to read from the front page of the Chicago Tribune. And I'm quoting directly from Above the Fold, Chicago Tribune, 1 week ago. Some of you maybe saw this article. It led with an LGBTQ tagline teaser. And this is the quote. The T stands for transgender. A teacher explains this on a State of Maine Department of Education website video. A transgender person is someone the doctors made a mistake about when they were born. But some people, when they get older, realize what the doctor said was not right. The grade level target for this propaganda indoctrination? Kindergarten. So we go back to the Apostle Paul's teaching in his letters to the Christian church at Colossae and at Ephesus, and we're reading from Colossians, familiar text, Colossians 4, and we'll read 2 through 6 of Colossians 4. Devote yourselves to prayer, being watchful and thankful, and pray for us too that God may open a door for our message so that we may proclaim the mystery of Christ, for which I am in chains. Pray that I may proclaim it clearly as I should, and be wise in the way that you act toward outsiders. Make the most of every opportunity. Let your conversation be always full of grace, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer everyone. And again, it's a parallel epistle in Ephesians 5. It will sound similar from verses 8 through 16. For you were once darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Live as children of light. For the fruit of the light consists in all goodness, righteousness, and truth, and find out what pleases the Lord. Have nothing to do with the fruitless deeds of darkness, but rather expose them. It's shameful even to mention what the disobedient do in secret, but everything exposed by the light becomes visible, and everything that is illuminated becomes a light. That's why it's said, "Wake up, sleeper, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you." Be very careful then how you live, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity, because the days are evil. Familiar passages from Paul's admonition to wake up Christian church. The legendary motivational speaker Zig Ziglar, some of you know this about him, he began his career with sort of this power of positive thinking messaging toward mostly salespeople in our country. But somewhere along the line, Zig Ziglar bumped into the gospel, and you may know this about him. He became a born-again Christian. And he had a question that he asked people that I think was practical and thought-provoking that I want us to contemplate this morning in the context of our Christian faith. Zig used to like to ask people at his conferences, "Who are you today? Are you a wandering generality, or are you a meaningful specific?" And I'm asking you that this morning, and I think God asks me this on a regular basis. Hey, are you a wandering generality in your faith, or are you a meaningful specific? And I want us, for the remainder of our time this morning, to look at what this means from a biblical doctrinal point of view. Because we know that there, again, were admonitions throughout the New Testament for us to be a people who set apart in our hearts. Peter wrote it this way, set apart in your heart Christ as Lord, and always be prepared to give an answer for anyone who asks you for the reason regarding the hope that you have, and do this with gentleness and respect. So this morning, when you think about your life trying to be a follower of Jesus Christ, are you a wandering generality, or are you a meaningful specific? Because my contention would be the reason some of these agendas are allowed to exist and rise up in the American church is because most of us can be wandering generalities when it comes to our faith. I believe in God. You know, I believe in the Bible. I know somewhere in there it says this. And, you know, I like that church. And I give an hour a week to church, all right? You know, on a good day, when I'm really generous, I throw even 15 or 20 bucks in the plate on Sunday. I mean, what else am I supposed to do? And I think we are a land of Christians who have become more of the wandering generality type than the meaningful specific. But when Paul wrote to his understudy in his second epistle to Timothy, the words that he writes are, again, a lot of us, the type of teaching that a lot of us have had committed to our memorization for a long time. From 2 Timothy chapter 1, I know this was one of the verses, and basically I'm just going to leave it and quote it. So when we were working with our kids on scripture memorization when they were little, this is one that was consistent. What did he say in those opening portions of that letter about verse 7, 2 Timothy? What did he say? For God has not given us what? A spirit of timidity or a spirit of fear. But what has he given us? Older NIV versions say a spirit of power and love and a sound mind. Newer translations say power, love, self-discipline. But what does he say right before that? He says, Timothy, remember when I laid hands on you and I prayed for you, I was praying for a spiritual gift in you. So if we're a people that want to follow Jesus and we want to be meaningfully specific with our faith, that means we recognize that God has given us a gift. Everyone here, everyone on the planet that has proclaimed Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord, God's given at least one spiritual gift. And what did Paul say to young Timothy about that gift? He said specifically, fan this gift into flame. Fan it into flame so this fire grows. And if you're here this morning and you're saying, boy, I don't know. I mean, what's my meaningful specific in kingdom endeavors? What's my meaningful specific when it comes to how God has given me a unique gifting? Here's my contention. What Jesus did with 12 and specifically three that he focused on resulted in us some 2,000 plus years now later talking about that work in Piatone, Illinois on a Sunday morning. There's more than 12 people in this room. There are plenty in the remnant of Jesus walking around today in this country. And unless we go from wandering generalities to meaningful specifics, the church will continue to allow progressive teaching. Pastors will continue to feel like there's really no reason for me to continue doing this job, but again, I don't know if I want to leave because I am getting a paycheck at least, and my family does at least have health insurance. But the calling's gone, the passion's gone, the belief that we can actually make a difference is gone. But when people get specific about fanning into flame the gift of God that's in every one of us, you know, when people talk to us, you know, talk to me specifically, and we'll say, you know, whether it's something breaks about the house or we're having some conversation about whatever topic of the day it is, you know, I like to say, you know, I don't feel like God has given me a lot of gifts. What I've tried to do is sort of, in a lot of respects, stay in my lane, try to fan the one or two gifts he's given me into flame, but I don't try to busy myself. In fact, as bad as this sounds, sometimes when I say, you know, I could be frustrated trying to fix that thing for the next 5 hours, or I could take 30 seconds and write the check, and it's just, let somebody who's in their lane using their gift, right? Amen? But when it comes to our discipleship, when it comes to us following Jesus, church, this morning, before I pray, I want to ask every one of us to examine what's going on in this world. What are we reading about on the front pages of our newspapers? What are we catching hour by hour in the 24-hour news cycle that's coming at us with the fire hose sort of force, right? What is your meaningful specific? Because if you are not deploying that gift of God that's in you for kingdom work, my strong challenge this morning is that you start to ask God to do that in you. I don't care if you don't have a dozen gifts. I don't care if you have five or three gifts. I'm going to promise you, everyone here this morning has a specific, at least one specific spiritual gift that God has said to us, fan this gift into flame. Make it burn hot, because we need that type of light in the world today. Amen? Let's pray. God, we're grateful. You're a holy God. You're a mighty God. Again, we've sung this morning about your conquering power and the challenges that all of us face that are going on in this world. You have not only conquered the grave, as we've sung, you've conquered death, you've given us the victory, you've conquered our health challenges, you've conquered our marriage challenges, you've conquered our addiction challenges. And God, this morning, I pray that you would help us to be a people that set aside the deeds of darkness and that we would put on the armor of light. And in doing that, God, you would remind each one of us, reveal each one of us in a way that we can understand what our spiritual gifting is. And God, just like the religious leaders of that day couldn't understand the gospel, may we be a people that embrace this great news that Jesus, you came to save us from our sins, you came to save us from ourselves, and you've given us a gift to serve you. May we fan it into flame in Jesus' name. Amen and amen.
If you would stand with us, we'll finish our morning worship.